Okay, so we'll do a roll call.
Very good. DeCreger. Wendover. Snyder.
Here.
Brown.
Here.
Taylor.
Here.
DeBrager.
Here.
King.
Here.
Okay, has everybody had a chance to look over the, we had approved the agenda for tonight. Is there a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, no public is here today, so no public comment, unless we have any kind of correspondence.
No, none whatsoever.
Okay. Now, we're going to look at the November 18th minutes. Okay, is there a motion to adopt?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, we have no public hearing tonight. New business, election of the officers to 2004 agenda.
Can we do this the simple way and keep everybody on and make a motion?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Man, we had talked earlier. You can do that. Yes, you can do that. But, man?
Well, I think I would like to see if anyone else would like to take the chairmanship for a while. It would be nice to have somebody. Because I think you can press upon occasionally, a different perspective.
You're the most knowledgeable on the mission. It makes sense.
The education is that.
Just makes sense, man.
It does.
I make a motion that we, how do I word this? Nominate once again, Nan for chair, Dean for vice, and Mark for secretary.
Only thing I would like to say, ma'am, you are the chairman. This is something that we can table. Yes, you can table.
Yeah.
This is a commission that functions as it should, and yes.
The only thing that I was thinking is I am going to be gone the month of February and March like I was last year, maybe even the first week of April, hopefully not. So I'm not going to be here, so that would delay it unless you all wanted to vote without me. But I really wanted Ed and James' perspective on this in case one of them would like to take over the chairmanship. Ed expressed that he would be dropping out or he's traveling somewhere, so I don't think you'll hear anything from Ed. And I think Dean's quite happy to be invited.
Well, I'd like to hear what they have to say.
All right, we can table
but
it.
But my concern, I guess, is how long can this be tabled? And if you do have meetings while I'm out of town, it's just going to have to be run by Dean, correct? I mean, we just carry on the way we are right now. We need to take over as vice president until we can vote on this.
Mm-hmm. I'd prefer to do that if we could, just to give them an opportunity until we're all here at the next meeting, which would probably be the end of
Would you like to make a motion to
I'd like to make a motion. Someone who would like to motion.
That's okay. That's all right. Yeah, I get it. I understand.
To table the election of the officers for 2014 until a meeting where we're all here, which would probably be the first April.
And it can be tabled that long?
My understanding, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, I'll second that motion.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
We may not even have any work applications or something, so it's very possible that that would be a motion.
That's the question I guess I had, being as I'm new, I don't know what your history is of work applications. I believe last year, possibly during the winter, late spring,
March we had one.
You had one in March, and I believe that had to do with the Housing Commission, probably. But, I will double check with Jerry, but from what I've read and what I understand, I do not see a problem tabling it.
I just
I actually did just confer with Jerry on that.
Okay.
I thought there was enough other things too, but he seemed to think that would be fine as long as we voted on it. So,
sure.
Let's do that.
Can I, personally, can I ask, how many years have you been chairman?
Okay. Has it been like 4 times? It was after then we moved. So two years, because prior to Wendy was Mary Duda.
Last year's project with updating the, the ordinance is huge.
Yeah.
I know that's a huge project. So that the motion passed to table. Next item.
Okay, the next one is review and approval of the 2013 annual report. Has everybody had a chance to read that over?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got a little bit of credit that's not due to me.
Okay.
Nan is the sole commissioner who worked on the research and reference library at the museum.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm listed as working with her on that, and I didn't have anything to do with that. I don't know if that has anything.
Minor correction.
Just take that out. There was one other typo, and I've been trying to find it since I read it. And it is in reference to some maps that we were working on at the Sanborn maps that I had mentioned were available at the Historical Society. And it was spelled, it was not spelled Sanborn. And I've been trying to find that in the spelling ever since. I can't find it. It might have been on the November.
And it's just the spelling of the word?
Yeah, you have like something else. It's Sanborn, S-A-N-B-O-R-N. It may have been on the November. I apologize, but I've not been able to find it since I read it.
I believe it may have been in the
November map.
November.
Which?
It probably would have been. I've got another copy here.
Oh,
yeah.
I have it. Each three of the November minutes
are
referred to
Sidwell Man. There you go. Should be Sandborn. And you know what? I apologize, because we've already approved those minutes.
Well, we can amend that.
Okay.
Erin, what page was that on?
That's on page three. And it is the eighth block of text down the page.
Mm-hmm. So if we can amend the approval.
Yes, make a motion to amend the spelling. And the spelling, S-A-N-D?
No, S-A-N-B, like a boy. O-R-N.
S-A-N-B?
Mm-hmm. O-R-N. It's not a big deal, that.
Sure, amend the correct spelling.
No.
That's fine.
So I'll make a motion to amend the November minutes.
Second.
All favor.
Aye.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Can I just comment to represent where we are?
Yeah.
I think I missed that meeting, but I said, I don't know who received that if I replied to everybody, just Jerry. You said that information, is it with insurance?
The Sandler maps themselves? Yeah, the Sandler maps were, it was a Sandler insurance company.
Okay.
Yeah, that did them, and they started in as early as the 1880s.
Okay.
And Cadillac, we had them running from, I think it's probably 7 different years. I just got them electronically downloaded, and I could, this is something that we need to talk about, whether or not I want to get them to the city. We've got them, I could send them to you as well if you want on a CD or something.
The information that I received, the issues on the home, they were quite a few years, and that's, it's just a concern of mine, using that. The West Edition and the East Edition,
mm-hmm.
It was like, I think it was like as much as 7 or 10 years off.
Well, there's the Sandler maps only exist like every 4 to 5 years. So you're saying that on the Sandborn Master Plan, or on what?
Gosh, it was probably a year ago.
Oh, okay.
And I was talking about the additions you sent it to me. But it was just the information was not correct.
Okay. Well, we'll have to... Oh, okay. So maybe it was part of the study report?
It's specific to my one.
Right. Yes. Part of the study report that was done?
No, it was after. This was about a year and a half ago you sent us the information.
Yeah, I guess I don't know.
We'll have to talk about that a little bit.
But the point of the Sandborn Master is a great research tool. And we've got them available electronically now because we have them scanned at the museum. Mm-hmm. And they're available there in hard copy and as well as electronically. So the only point I was trying to make is I'd like to be able to get them somehow on the city website at some point because we do provide a great resource tool for people that want to study what has happened to their home or their building over the course of time. Because it shows additions, it shows when a story was built or taken off, when it was demolished, that type of thing. It shows the footprint of the building. It only shows that for certain parts of the city of Cadillac, but so I just wanted to point that out.
A link, something like a link?
Not really. This had to be scanned.
Okay, scanned and loaded.
We could put it on the PDF. We could make it a PDF file. And that would work. So going back to the annual report, are there any other additions? And I do want to say thank you very much for putting this together. You guys did a great job on this, synopsizing the year.
Well, it was an effort Jerry and I, obviously, with me not starting here until the end of June. I was able to put together part of it, and of course, Jerry's the writer in the department. He's mm-hmm. very good at it.
Okay. Are there any other edits?
That is
is actually part of our charge, the civil legislative community. So I think we need to take that up on that. And I think workshops would be one way to do that. And I guess, we need to think about that and come up with ideas and suggestions.
And then the knowledge and they also have to create a little more interest.
Yeah,
great
community
around
for a district, yeah.
And we can think about things like how to repair or maintain your windows.
Yeah.
And that's a big deal. That would be lovely, but then we'll do it much closer and you'll need to do it much closer. Was it just something about lead-based paint?
And things like that, like when I think about stuff that is kind of on a long line with a potential help.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are grants and funding through the health department that we might be able to tap into a partnership out with, which we can come to that stuff where I work. And so I think for some of those things, or even how to maybe do some energy efficiencies in your historic home and maintain the historic, so maybe, you know, I think those would be some things of interest that could get people going. And it would help their bottom line, but then also help us be able to teach, you know, how to do that and keep the guidelines ever present when we're considering things like that.
Yeah, we have a lot
there.
Of
insurance. Yeah, and I think, you know, there is grant money through, like I said, the health department, sometimes through the Department of Community Health for things like that. There's initiatives every year. The money usually goes to the same place. They usually go to the community action in the community, the health department, but, you know, we can partner with them and get a piece of that action. Which things that would interest me as a homeowner in the historic district, you know, as a parent with a young family, you know, those are things that I'd be really interested in participating in. There are some younger families moving in, and so that might be a way to get them interested and then they're hooked.
Yeah, and I think sometimes you can't use a daunting task for some moments and get overwhelmed and think, I can't get to it, it's too small. But there are a lot of things that you can do yourself.
Yeah.
And if we can help educate them on how to do that, I think it's something.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting, maybe more, even before this was all in reality, where sort of those meetings and have people from that actually come up and answer questions, and that was, you know, very informative.
Would be good for like future commission recruitment too. You know, if directors are commissioned, like that might be a good idea.
Absolutely. There's a lot of qualified contractors out there in organizations that we can work with. Yeah, and I think you're right about the, you know, partnering with the committee on project group and organization.
Yep.
Okay. Let's keep thinking about that. Maybe we, during the winter months, take a look at what some of the other communities are doing. Places like Grand Rapids and Kalamazoo and Lansing have regular workshop programs like that. There's actually quite a bit in Gautica. Bay City. So,
we don't have to deal.
Right. No, we don't.
And we had some talks some time back. I don't know if you recall that. At the, I'm going from the moment right now, the Ed Funch, the son, who's a curator and wife's a curator, and they both came and did some talks. I think that one was more geared towards artifacts, preservation in the museum itself, but they might have some other outlets and references for it to that community too, for the actual building preservation side of things, you know. And I know they certainly have lots of data about restoring, preserving, you know, from linens, textiles, documents. Yeah.
Is that how she
Yeah, but I don't remember that. Which I don't think they're doing more, but I know we can talk to her.
And this is Historic Preservation Network, the nonprofit, and statewide can help us with this, too.
Yeah.
Plus, you know, we have a lot of connections through them. But we could almost work something out as well. So I think there's a lot of opportunities. I think we just got to decide what, where, and how.
Right.
So it would really be helpful to kind of get a pulse, to get a feeling of a pulse of the community and what they're looking for. So maybe in our talks with people around town, we can find out what they think might be most helpful
and put it in the newsletter.
Yeah. property owner that's got some type of a flyer, and you know, be happy to offer some suggestions on that, and say, you know, that's this, and send it back into us, or drop it off at the city. Mm-hmm. If we had a handful of them, it would be more than what we've got right now.
Something I will do too, I'll make some phone calls. You mentioned other communities and try and find out from some people. As you said, more communities that are doing workshops that I can inquire to, where they're successful getting grants and where they got them through.
Yeah, and make sure the workshops were best attended.
Sure.
What community people's interest in that.
I can put a little bit of information, Mike, too, that I think I can get out to you in the past.
Sure. I've got time. I will certainly make some phone calls and,
some different topics.
Sure.
So, the other thing that I think I would like to recommend in another potential role next year is the website, and I know that it looks like you kind of got that down in 2013. Just continuing to update that with more preservation education. Information. I think we just usually need more of the website. Though it looks really good. Come along with it. And just wondering if anybody had any other thoughts.
I think we discussed this once. And just resources. Let's just say I'm a homeowner. I'm not involved in the street, but I got a home there. I want to do something. I mean, kind of talk to them once, but they have a central place.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe we have a personalizing place to do this.
Right.
But, you know, get some decent. That we need to work or something. A place where we have a small library of resources.
Mm-hmm. You know, we just finished that research library at the museum, and it's more history based. The biggest problem we have there is that we're not open very long, from December to April. So I'm wondering if we might not want to put together some resources that we can have here and also duplicate them there. So that people go to either place. I mean, I'd be happy to participate in that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we need to talk about how we want to present that. Whether or not we want to have hard copies here and people can come in, look at it, and have copies made by the city for them, or what? You know, how are we going to disperse this information? We can come up with some fact sheets and some resource guides and that type of thing that would be easy to hand out. But if you wanted to go to the next step and do like some preservation briefs, which are maybe, you know, 10 to 15 pages, you could keep, a lot of cities do this, they keep hard copies in a notebook.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody comes in and says, I need some help on Monday, they pull that out and make a copy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so I guess the question I would have is, how would the city want to facilitate that?
I don't see where that would be a problem. You know, if we have a copy of it here, do you know roughly how many documents, books, things this might be?
Well, preservation briefs, we spoke, you're talking about probably 30 of them, and 30 to 35 of them, and maybe an average of 10 to 15 pages a piece. But, you know, we only have to do it one time.
Yeah.
For people that are electronically astute, you know, you can give them a resource guide. They can go right to the National Park Service and download it themselves. But then there are a lot of people that don't have access to a computer or don't know how to do that. And that's when it's handy to have a hard copy here.
Sure.
But you don't have to have every book.
Besides the library and museum, how about the public library here?
That too would be nice to have it there as well. Absolutely.
Mark, were you also indicating, in addition to that, kind of a how-to's of it, were you talking about a resource list of builders, like for if you want to put in a new oak floor, but you know, you have an old oak floor, but you're told it's been sanded and re-sanded so many times, there's no redoing it, and it's sanded down so far that the tummy groove pieces are gone, and some people are to that point of maybe a new floor perhaps, but they may want to put in an oak floor that matches what was there, you know? So there are certain
time between the recommendation and then the
The city itself would not give any recommendation to a contractor or to a specific product. And what we have done before is people have asked questions about a contractor, not necessarily for a home in the historic district, but you know, quite frankly, we might do nothing more than, make a photocopy of the page out of the book. We have to be very careful about recommending a specific contractor or a product, which we don't have to do.
I know the chamber they'll recommend things based on a member.
I mean, there's some people that, we've talked about this before, and it's one of the reasons we shied away from is because of that. But we talked about maybe things that are listed for contractors that are knowledgeable to do certain trades.
You know, one thought that the Electronic Preservation Guild has somewhat of a limited role in that it's kind of a behind the scenes sort of thing, you know, just a more emerging vehicle sort of situation and to try to support efforts that are going on in the historic structures in town. But that would be possibly, since it's a nonprofit and it's not publicly funded, that would be an outlet where perhaps they could be referred to the nonprofit preservation guild, and we could keep on file with the guild a list of individual professionals that folks in the district at minimum have had good luck with. This person is very receptive to restoring the windows versus telling you to rip down the window and all. You know what I mean? And they're really good at doing both if you're beyond that point, and maybe you have non-contributing or a vinyl or whatever the situation is. But my contractor, for instance, but if you don't know the name of that particular group, most of these people you don't find in the phone book, that's the thing. Those that really are gifted as well versed in historic homes and will also be willing to accommodate the customer.
Right.
Without just a new build mentality, you know?
Right.
But it's really a niche and it's kind of specific, so.
When it comes to maybe naming some of the individual contractors that are skilled in those particular trades, maybe that would be the reading of it. To go through the guild on that. But I think we could come up with something. I think we just need to know a format. Maybe that's just something we can chip away at this next year.
My opinion is, if these resources are there, if the preservation groups are there, I mean, there should be a way to get it in hopefully more than one location.
Right.
From there, possibly the Wesley County Library also have a set, that sort of thing. Because then, too, they're open days of the week that this office is not.
Right. I think it would be good to have this preservation notebook available, or a couple of notebooks available for all, and have an electronic version that can be updated as well. See, I think the same one should be in there too. This week, we're going to look at the 17th and hold it up in there. The guidance. Very valuable information. But anyway, I think the major focus is supposed to be about maintaining this year, the buildings and the resources available for those.
Kind of along the lines, just an idea I had along the lines of website, can be updated and also trying to reach out and do more education with the community. Is I wonder on our newsletters if we want to register for and get a QR. Those black and white things coming into your phone, because what it would do then is you could scan it and get our website, get the website pulled right up, and, a lot of people access the internet through their phones. They don't necessarily need a computer or their tablet, and so if we had and they're free, you can go to a lot of websites and, create a unique QR, and then it would link them automatically to our part of the city's website, where they could get more information about the historic district and preservation and the work might be a good way to kind of get more people interested. And if we list our website, that's one thing, but you can't make it any easier than just scan this with your phone, and then all of a sudden, there's the information.
And that's the wave of the future. I have that Christmas card issue with those on it.
Yeah. We have this website calling.
Scan this, and you'll get our video.
Yeah.
So
that may be, especially once we start, if we're eliciting input for workshops, or we have a workshop scheduled for 2014-2015, we might want to register for QR and start utilizing that, so that more and more people can quickly link on to our website and see what we've got going on. And there would also be a link that would say email us, you know, and it could email if they have questions or ideas or input. So maybe that could be part of our newsletter update this year and website update, is to register for QR and get that ready for
My knowledge of the website is limited, but, you know, certainly will inquire what capabilities we have.
Yeah, I was wondering, like, do you think, we don't know that we, is there one available for the city right now for anything that you know?
I've got to be honest, I don't have a smartphone. I still have an old cell phone, and I'm not sure.
I think they would have to have something, but let's think about that.
Yeah, that would be a great idea.
That's hot. It's interesting when you see one, you kind of want to check it out.
Right.
My agency got one this year, and I helped do it, and it was like 4 clicks. You know, it was very easy, it was free, you don't have to pay anything, and then you have even more immediate access. Well, I mean, you don't even have to type anymore. They can just scan and see everything that we want to get out to the public that might increase our penetration in terms of getting people interested.
Mm-hmm. I think that's my storage. Okay, well, that gives us something to think about.
The other thing I think, and Ed had mentioned this in his email to us, that he wanted us to start figuring out about a recommendation to the city that we had been discussing. Thank you. For the MDOT building. So I don't know what his timeline is on that, and I'm not necessarily hip to all the text and summons and history with that, but I wanted to make sure I brought that up. Ed had said, don't forget to bring this up.
It is some of the new tax information that do expire in 2014.
Well, I think what we were recommending too was us pushing forward or thinking about recommendations for commission to put forth to the city council, because
preservation.
For instance, I don't know the status if they are still in arrears on the taxes, but as of the last time we spoke about this building, they were still in arrears on the taxes, which were not a lot of money when you compare that to what they're trying to sell the building for, you know, and it's like, well, if they can't pay the taxes, the building eventually would essentially go back to the prior owner, you know, whether that is considered the city was the last owner, I believe, versus the county, right? Then the county feed it over the city, we'd be able to just buy for a dollar. So, if what I'm remembering happened, but, you know, if it were to go back to the city, you know, then it's a city asset, which of course is still an asset to the city anyway, but I mean, for the city administration, you know what I mean? And I know those that were administering the city at the time were not really interested in having it as an asset. That's why they out the door for a buck, you know? But it's a tremendous asset, you know? And it could be very viable in just so many different radioactive uses, you know? If it's an office building, great, you wouldn't have to do. I know there's infrastructure they've talked about, but like the roof that was supposed to be the $1 million slate roof, they redid that on the asphalt. So the big, you know, horrible expense of that is over, so it's more the infrastructure stuff that has to be aesthetic quite nice, you know, from what we've seen just from the civic events there and whatnot. So anyway, I just think it's a tremendous asset and it should be, you know, years and, you know, just the ideas of what would the city want to do with it. But it's even things like where we are now, before none of this was prime real estate in Cadillac, but now the lakefront is more along the lines of prime real estate as far as Cadillac goes, you know, and this whole area that was made into a city administrative area is right on the lakefront. Property that could be, you know, sold and developed and put on the tax rolls and, you know, this kind of a thing. So this is really the best utilization of this area that we're in as the city buildings, you know, where the city buildings are occupying the space. So, you know, who knows? Don't know if the
studio apartments and dorm sort of situation where people rent as a dorm, but you know what I mean. Something where it's managed.
Yeah, I think probably this is something that we need to put on our agenda in the spring, again, when we're all back here, and particularly at because this is something that's been really spearheaded. So I think, you know, we need to confirm that. Maybe this would be something we can do in April on shelter status again, because I think we talked about this last summer. I think it was like June, July. I can't remember what month it was that we had the owners here talking to us, but, you know, we'd be approaching a year later now, so what's the latest?
Right.
It would be good to do an update
and I mean, how far out do they get to go, not really meeting their end of the bargain, so to speak, and, you know, not being able to maintain the property as they're supposed to be?
Yeah, I think as long as the building is maintained, it's okay. I think it's...
But even as a commercial property or what a property period, the fact that they're in arrears and taxes.
Well, yeah.
How long have they been in arrears and taxes? Something that's been a while.
And understanding where they are with that and whether or not they're going to be coming up on the tax sale.
Yeah.
I mean, that would be something we would need to evaluate and take into consideration as well. So whether we want to make a recommendation in the city. It's a complicated situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that an issue that you could find information out for us, Mike, on that Codge Mitchell building, their current status and their...
As far as the taxes,
yeah.
I know there's been nothing, no new developments, because I did ask Jerry, figuring, knowing this would be at some point discussed, there are absolutely no new developments. I don't see any reason why I can't look up and let you folks know if the taxes on it are current or not.
And how long they've gone on the fleet, you know?
When would it be eligible for a tax sale? You know, I guess we need to know that if in fact that's the case. Or are they just paying this 1 year at a time straight just ahead of it? You know, I don't know.
Just last week in the Cadillac paper, there was a list of the 2011 delinquent taxes that I believe are at that point getting ready to, you know, legal action to take them. So, you know, I'm guessing if they had 2011 in the paper, then, you know, you're looking out there. But I'll certainly check into that for you.
No, and I guess I'd just like to add that I think we need to have this on the agenda sometime this spring.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the best way to address it and to try to have as much information as possible before we come to the meeting so we're all a little bit, and so we can discuss it. So possibly we could do that in a bit longer.
It is in the minutes to be put on this spring agenda, so it will be.
And the only thing I have is I did bring in copies of the Historical Studies Research Library, a little summary. They have given this, which is so excited about it. We're not really promoting this yet because we're doing this closed for the winter. So even though we completed this in November, we're basically waiting until May to promote it to the public. So I hope to have some, you know, news coverage on there, so we will be opening this up and showing people, so maybe at some point we'll have some kind of open house, mm-hmm. and maybe we could do a tour here as part of our meeting just to run over there and show you briefly what we have.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway. And I'll give you a copy of this tomorrow. It's just to see what we got. But there is a file cabinet there that's got Cadillac historic home files and historic preservation. We are certainly searching historic preservation and search information there, but there's a lot of information on a lot of homes and buildings in Cadillac that we got from both the survey that was done as well as home tours that have been done and other resources. So.
Anybody have anything else?
The historical society building, which I don't know if you're on.
It could be by an appointment.
Okay.
And you can work through either calling or our online website email, and Tom will come over and open it for
somebody.
It's from about December, November we'll open a little bit, but by December, until April, and then we sort of remain there.
thanks everybody for working so hard this year.
Thank you.
Hopefully you're gone in February and March enjoying yourself.
Yeah, a little bit warmer, not a lot, a little bit.
That's
right.
It's only 37 degrees today.
Wow. Yeah, well, I don't know.
Tells explicitly when everybody's term is up.
Okay.